Hey, kids, we're a couple of annoyed grunt boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons Podcast.
Levi's make me money. They're worth a lot, they say.
And I shall wear sweatpants, and I shall stretch the waistband. Ooh, and I shall wear sweatpants, covering my gorgeous can. Morning, Jerry.
That's right. We're the podcast that explores the American animated sitcom The Simpsons from seasons 11 and beyond, and the newest episodes when they're available. Why do we do it like this? Well, first of all, plenty of other podcasts explored the quote-unquote golden age of The Simpsons, that being seasons 1 through 10, but also an entity known as the Wheel of Random has trapped us and forced us to watch these episodes in such a manner. I say we because I am one annoyed grunt boy named Steve. And with me, as always, is the other annoyed grunt boy, Craig. Hello, Craig. How are you doing this week?
Wonderful. How about you?
Well, Craig, I'm a little cheesed off, if you will.
Cheese.
Yeah, cheese is good, but the media is off.
Oh, man. What do the media do now?
Okay, well, first of all, we're a Simpsons podcast, so I figure we should talk about Simpsons things first and foremost.
I'd rather talk about baseball.
I'm sure we can talk about baseball later, but for now.
Okay.
Recently, there was an episode in which Barfly Larry passed away.
Not Larry,
good old Barfly Larry, and we still don't know where his buddy Sam is, but we talked about that episode. And you can go back and listen to it. But whenever there is a Simpsons event in the news, like a character dying or whatever, friends and family and people who know me to be a Simpsons fan. So they'll send me a lot of information. It's always a lot of like, did the Simpsons predict this or whatever? And I just wanted to take a moment to express some frustration that I've had because there have been a number of articles that people sent to me about Larry dying. And it's clear to me that the authors of these articles, assuming that they're not AI, are just filling space to make a thing. And it's clear that they have not watched or cared about The Simpsons for some time. One such article is from E! Online, and it talks about how they're killing off an original character for 35 years, and how depressed and distraught Simpsons fans are to lose Larry. And another one from NBC News says that Larry Dalrymple was on the show for 35 years and, true to his nickname, was often seen at Moe's Tavern drinking beer. Now, I know that we refer to him as one of the barflies, but that's not really a nickname. That's just a descriptor. And it's not like Homer is like, oh, there's the barfly Larry. I think TMZ kind of did it right because it says, Simpsons producer Tim Long says, sorry if Larry's death got to you. That was the point. But basically, my whole argument is that so many Simpsons articles, some of its media is written just to get clicks so people who are friends or family of people who like The Simpsons will be like, oh, that person will be interested in this, rather than actually caring about The Simpsons at all. The authors are just like trying to fill space saying Simpsons words and saying how the show's been on for 35 years and how it's popular. And I don't know. I guess it's so far removed from Simpsons fandom actually, that it just kind of annoys me. Really grinds my gears, as old Homer Simpson would say.
It's weird that Simpsons is just such a presence in our life. Are your friends and family still watching The Simpsons? Or is it just you and I?
I feel like, honestly, like it's mostly you and I. Like,
and our fans.
Yeah, of course. And our fans. And like I appreciate people like Timothy or Kate and all of other fans who do listen to the show and, you know, are like giving the show a chance and like kind of doing what our experiment's all about is like finding the good in the new episodes. But I feel like so many people are either surprised that it's still on the air or that they're just saying that like, it's still good, and they don't actually give it a chance to actually watch it.
I think it's the opposite. I don't think they say it's still good. They're like, oh no, Simpsons sucks, we don't watch it anymore. And that was kind of the conceit of this whole podcast.
That is true.
All of that naysay. You know, you talk about how just for the shock of, like, ooh, The Simpsons kill off a character and it makes you feel, you know, something, like you're sad. Like, yeah, we talked about in review, like, it was well done for making you feel for a character that doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that all these people were like, wow, The Simpsons carrying off this beloved character, you didn't give two shits about Larry. You never did. You never will.
Right. And that's kind of what really kind of gets my goat, is that they're making it like a big thing. And you're right about people not really listening, because I will also often, when there's a new episode, go to like a subreddit, like a Simpsons subreddit even, and so many of the comments were like, oh, I didn't even realize the Simpsons were still on the air, or it hasn't been good since 1993 or whatever.
And that's just Schwartz Welder right?
Exactly.
The Simpsons subreddit, I think, is mostly just memes, isn't it?
Pretty much, yeah.
I haven't delved into the subreddit of Simpsons in a while. Well, I mean, I could go right now. Let's look. Maybe there's something interesting about this week's episode that we might not touch upon. I don't even see a thing about discussing the latest episode. Oh, because I'm on Simpsons. I got to go to The Simpsons. There we go.
Mine says, we lost a real king recently. He was innocent for sure. Oh, that's a different Simpsons subreddit altogether.
Oh, Steve.
All right. So, yeah, there's still discussion for like this episode we were in Telltale Pants. Another reason why we don't really talk about Reddit or go there that much is just because then, you know, we read other people's opinions, then that might get forced into our opinions. So.
Mm-hmm.
The top comments here, you know, nothing too scandalous, but, you know, someone's like, nice callback to Ned's music. Did someone catch Larry's urn at the bar? Marge has been really good this season. The yes guy is back. Yeah.
That's fair.
There's not a lot of negative stuff here. All right. Well, hey, I'm not going to continue reading because you probably want to hear us talk more about The Simpsons later. But I think the whole point is, if you're going to talk about something, at least watch it, right?
Exactly. And, you know, I think we're all guilty of seeing an article headline and not actually reading the article. So, you know, I've done it. Craig's done it. We've all done it. So do your due diligence and read your articles and, you know, just be aware of the media that you're consuming. And speaking of media, let's go back in time, all the way back to May 5th, 2024. Craig, what was the number one movie in the box office?
Steve, isn't it almost summer? We're talking about the fall guy. It's almost the summer. We should have the summer guy.
Yeah, I would have thought that would have come out in October.
Yeah. No, it's the Barbie man himself, the office's wife herself, the fall guy, yeah, with Ryan Gosling and Emily Blunt.
That's right.
You know, have you ever met Emily Blunt? You know, I've talked to her many times, but she's just very honest with me every time she sees me, you know, like, points out, you know.
Straight to the point.
Straight to the point, yeah. She also really loves marijuana, you know? Likes to smoke a joint.
With a cigar.
What does that mean?
Oh, wait, no, that's Emily Spliff. Never mind.
Ooh, okay. Emily Blunt. You know, every time I'm hanging out with Ryan Gosling, he's always breaking. He's always funny. Always dressing up like Beavis from Beavis and Butthead.
Mm-hmm.
But we love him. We love him. He's the new Ryan Reynolds, right?
Yeah, and somehow slightly less annoying.
Yeah, I think Ryan Reynolds is like on the tip of like, we've had enough of you, Ryan.
Yeah, and he's been like on that tip for like 5 years now. If you were,
yeah,
like, he hasn't crossed over yet, but he's like close. I think when Deadpool 3 comes out, we'll all like him again.
Yeah, yeah.
But for now, it's like,
yeah. All right. I never watched The Fall Guy as a child. I think that was like Kids of the 70s. Really, that was kind of one of their shows. I don't know if it's for me, Steve. I don't know.
Yeah, it just feels like it's a movie that they made so that they could have like Ryan Gosling star in a thing.
And like, I guess it didn't do too well. And it made like 28 million, and that's not that much. They were expecting gangbusters, you know, because Ryan Gosling is so it now. But you know what probably people were really seeing, which was the number two movie, which we never talked about the number two, but you know what the number two movie, Steve, was?
What's that?
Star Wars Episode One, The Phantom Menace.
Oh, yeah.
25th anniversary. The movie, like, no one likes, but they're like, hey, apparently made a lot of money. This is kind of crazy. Like, I think we've hit that age where the old Star Wars movie, the original three, that's, you know, our Star Wars or your grandpa's Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
But the prequels now, all the kids that grew up with that, they're all in their, you know, mid-20s now, late 20s, almost 30s probably.
Mm-hmm.
That's their Star Wars movies.
And I feel like there's a lot of apologists for the movie now, like, or not apologists, but like people who are like, The prequels were actually good.
Well, if you compare it to like again, we're not a Star Wars podcast. Maybe one of these days, but like, you know, if you look at the Disney, the core Disney ones, not the like Rogue Ones or Solos, but like episodes 7, 8, and 9, kind of almost prefer the prequels.
Yeah, at least you're a bit more original storytelling.
Yeah, I think I've maybe seen Rise of Skywalker once, and that was in, once or twice. Yeah, I think I've only seen Foley once, and that was in the theater. Again, not a Star Wars podcast, not a Fall Guy podcast, or a Simpsons podcast. But before we do the Simpsons, Steve, we need to talk about music.
Oh, yes.
What's the number one song? Just give me the artist for the, let's say the top 55 songs.
So at number one, we have Taylor Swift singing right. about everyone's favorite video game, Fortnite.
Right. Featuring
Becker himself, Post Malone. and then so for number 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, we have Taylor Swift.
Okay.
15, we have Benson Boone with Beautiful Things.
I don't care about that. Let's just go all the way. Just listen to how many Taylor Swift tracks are on the Hot 100.
Okay, so her latest...
All of them, right?
Yeah, so her latest album has 31 tracks, which some may argue is too many. And those 31 tracks are on all on the charts, the lowest one ranking at 55, and that one's Robin, so I don't know where Nightwing falls or the Red Mask, but...
I'm not familiar with Robin.
Dick Grayson.
You think she's talking about... Yeah, no, do you think she's talking about Dick, or she's talking about Jason, or Tim, Stephanie, Damien? Which Robin is she talking about? Or is she talking about Givens or Quivers?
Oh.
Maybe
Leech.
Hood? Yeah, Hood, Leech, or even the bird.
Maybe. I mean, we did learn recently that the bird is what the England country
UK's national bird. Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think of this, Steve? Taylor Swift just killing it again.
So I am not the Swiftie that you or others are. I did a perusal of the latest album, and she has a sound, I'll say.
Look, we don't want to get in trouble from Swifties or anything.
No. But
as someone who does listen to Taylor Swift and enjoys her work, there is a lot of the same vibe.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of variety, and it's almost just like we opened up her personal... She just opened up her diary and said, yeah, these are songs. Yeah. But it's a great album, Steve. This is great. It's great. I love it.
Oh, yeah. So good. So good.
Let's just go through the Hot Rock Alternative, which is Too Sweet by Hozier. Dance Electric Hot 100 is Dua Lipa's Houdini. And the country song is called Bar Song Tipsy by Shaboozy. And Bar Song Tipsy by Shaboozy. Steve, you know, we usually don't play the music anymore because of the copyrights issues, but I really got to hear what this
Thank you so much. And I was really hoping that you'd do this because I wanted to hear it too. Someone pour me up a double shot of whiskey. They know me and Jay Daniels got a history. There's a party downtown near Fifth Street. Everybody at the bar getting tipsy. Everybody at the bar getting tipsy. I've been boozy since I left. I ain't changing for a chair. Tell my mind I ain't forget. I'm not a big country guy, unless we're talking about the band Big Country. But I think it's a fun song. I think it captures the spirit of modern country very well. It adds a little something. I don't hate it. I don't know what country fans think of it, but I think it's good.
Yeah, like I can see this song being played at mini bars and karaoke joints, and then maybe getting annoyed by it after a little too much play.
That is true. I mean, I am listening to it through the lens, the auditory lens of never having to probably hear it again. And so, yeah, you do make a good point that if I had to hear it repeatedly, I'd probably grow to hate it. But for now, it's great. I will say that Shaboozy might be the best name of a country singer that I've ever heard. Well, Craig, that's all well and good. We know now who Shaboozy is and what he's all about. And we've talked about frustrations and what's popular. But let's get to the meat of this episode sandwich. It is season 35, episode 16, The Telltale Pants, in which Marge comes upon a surprising windfall, and angry with Homer, spends it secretly on herself. Let's give it a watch, and we'll take a little break, and we'll be right back.
And they shall believe us, and I shall wear sweatpants, and they shall believe us. Sweatpants for the husky man. Ha, ha,
We're back. Today we're talking about the Telltale Pants, the 16th episode of the 35th season. It originally aired on May 5th, 2024. It is episode 766 in the show's run. Your nerd code is 35ABF10. It was written by Al Jean, directed by Stephen Dean Moore, and your showrunner is Al Jean.
What a who's who of writers and directors and showrunners for this episode. How about that?
Indeed, yes.
Al Jean, you know, he's been around for a while.
A while.
This little show. It's always exciting to see it written by Al Jean, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You feel like as a showrunner, he's got so much on his plate that he sits down with his legal pad and just starts writing interior Simpsons
house.
Bart, you know, like, it's weird to think that the boss is like, all right, let me just write an episode.
Mm-hmm.
Or is it assigned to him? I feel like that's, you know, it's a, like, is it just like, fine, I'll do it myself. I hold my beer.
That's a good question. Because you figure with him running the show, he'll be assigning it to himself unless, like, Matt Selman was like, hey, you old-timer, do this. What the fuck?
Maybe it's, like, in his contract, is like, well, you still have to write at least an episode every couple of years.
Yeah, because it's been a minute since we last heard from him. I guess not too long ago.
Well, it seems like an episode from each season. Like, he did an episode from last season's, season 34, episode 13, which was The Many Saints of Springfield, which I believe was, I'm going to assume it's a Fat Tony episode.
It's yeah.
Probably a Sopranos parody. Okay. And then one from 33, season 33, episode 9, Mothers and Other Strangers. But that was way back in 2021, so I don't remember that episode. But you know some of the older ones, right, that we can't talk about.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when you look at some of his older work, like, you know, let's not omit his addition to him and Mike Reiss doing The Critic. And his work on Alf, the Johnny Carson show, and Gary Shandling show. But for The Simpsons, you know, Molding Lisa, The Telltale Head, he's got a thing. The Way We Was, Stark Raving Dad, the controversial episode, which we'll actually mention later on. Lisa's Pony, Round Springfield, the Mary Bobbins episode, Lisa Sachs, and finally, Ma and Pop. Art with the Outsider Art episode. I mean, these are like pretty classic. And then, you know, in the ones that we are allowed to watch, you know, guess who's coming to criticize dinner? Like, we did that way back in our 10th episode, which I think is a shame because that's such an iconic, great episode. And what we said to it probably wasn't great, but that's a great one.
How about Hello Gutter, Hello Fodder? We did that one. There's one that we haven't done and I've been looking forward to, and that's Homer, which H-O-M, and then backwards R from season 12, episode 9.
It's a great episode.
Yeah. Don't forget, of course, he worked on the movie, and we still have quite a few that we haven't reviewed yet.
Mm-hmm.
But Al Jean, is he a goat, Steve? Does he have Riz?
I think he, no cap, he is like giving icon.
I don't think I used Riz correctly, did I?
I have no idea, honestly.
Okay. See, I think we should have a third host on this podcast, and that person will be, you know, like age 21 to 27. No, maybe that's too old. Maybe age 21 to like 24.
Uh-huh.
So that way they can teach us the new slang of the day.
That's an idea.
Steve's like shaking his head at me like, no.
Listen, I like, okay, so I know that like TikTok loves to talk about like the generational divides and like Gen X versus millennials versus Zillennials versus Gen Z. And I don't want to like add fuel to that generational warfare fire, but I just don't know that if our fan base nor my patience could handle having somebody who probably doesn't even care about The Simpsons, if we're being honest. Like, I don't know. Do Gen Z kids, like, aside from like maybe buying a Lisa Simpson like t-shirt at H&M, do they know about The Simpsons?
Yeah, I mean, it's something that their grandparents grew up with.
Quite possibly, literally, yes.
Yeah. You're right. I guess we'll just talk about, let's see, what do, you know, we make the comment about millennials eating ass and stuff like that, but, you know, millennials are old now. So it's Gen Zs. What do they like? They like comedy that's not funny.
Uh-huh. They don't really like sex.
No, so no sex, no comedy unless everyone's included.
Yeah.
We're sounding a little too much like Jerry Seinfeld. We were a backup, Steve.
Yeah.
controversial comedian Jerry Seinfeld.
Yes. He's got a lot to say, and all of his controversial takes, you know, they're trying to take him down and his hot views on breakfast food. I just am not sure that the Gen Z would be interested, or if I'd be interested in them being on the show. That's not to say that if we have fans who are of that age, like, by all means, welcome, and we're glad you're here. We love all our listeners.
Yeah, hey, Gen Zers, call in. Use your phone. That's the thing that you're holding in your hand right now.
Yeah, make phone calls, too.
Yeah. Or I know email's not cool. God, we should just have a TikTok, I guess. That's how people have to get to us, I guess.
Yeah, I know.
We're gonna do those videos where it's like how to Simpsons podcast, and then like, you know, we're not talking and just be like the text, but then we'll like point up to like something,
right,
like point down, give stupid faces.
Do a little dance.
Yeah. Our faces will have like a filter on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then if we move too fast, that filter goes away for a second, and we'll see the hideousness that we are.
Ugh.
Yeah. Lately now, my TikToks, here's my TikTok update.
Oh, good.
Now I just get nothing but, like, baseball TikToks.
That's not bad.
No, it's not. You know, I'll just sit there and watch, like, funniest ejections or funniest, or the funniest ejection was Barry Bonds and, you know, Mark McGwire ejecting steroids in them. But I'm not talking about those injections. Ejections, Steve.
Right.
Injections. No, but, you know, like, funny at-bats or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I get a lot of the Savannah Bananas, which if you haven't seen anything in those videos, they're like the Harlem Globetrotters, but for baseball.
Sounds fascinating.
And it's new. It's not old. So
I don't know how you showboat in baseball. Like,
it's pretty fun, though. I recommend taking a look at a couple of videos.
Okay.
I would have fun going to a Savannah Bananas baseball game. But that's my algorithm on the TikToks. How about you?
It's mostly either cooking tips or video game hot takes. Like, Last of Us wasn't good, but then it's a stitch of somebody saying Last of Us was good, and just like that. And I am a casual gamer, probably. I mean, like, I go through phases, but if you like a game or you don't like a game, I don't care. People's opinions of games are irrelevant to me because I just play whatever I want to play and derive whatever joy I get out of it or don't. And I think that's kind of way, like, I don't care how popular it is or isn't. And I don't know. My biggest issue with TikTok is that everyone thinks that they're like the main character of the movies. And so they'll say things as if it matters. And then another person who thinks they're equally important will respond as if they're an authority on the thing that they're talking about. And they're both just some jackass who doesn't know what they're talking about. So that's kind of where I'm at with TikTok.
Speaking of some jackasses that don't know what they're talking about, let's continue the show, Steve. So Al Jean, were you excited to see Al Jean's name on the credits?
I was. I'm excited to see what this episode's all about. You know,
probably 22 minutes?
Yeah, probably about 21, 39 or something like that.
I think the problem with Al Jean is you feel like you have to have this episode set it like at a high standard, right?
Right.
So it's, we'll see how this goes, Al. You know, if the annoyed grump boys don't like it, then you'll definitely not know about it.
Exactly. But Craig, do we have any sort of like opening salvo, some sort of, I don't know, some way to start to begin the episode?
You act like we don't do this bit all the time. Like, what's the couch gag? Why would you phrase it like that? That's weird.
I don't know. I just was looking for a natural transition, and I thought that we could just pace over it, but we couldn't. So, hey, Craig, do you have a couch gag?
Yeah, if this was like the first episode, you could phrase it like that.
I'm just wondering, you know, with all this talk of Gen Z, like, maybe we do have some new listeners, you know, maybe Gen Z listeners, and I want to make them feel included as well.
True. Like we always say, every podcast, you know, could be someone's first podcast. It's the Stan Lee-ism. You know, Stan Lee always said any Marvel comic should read as if it's someone's first comic. So our podcast, we were bitten by radioactive spiders and developed a really horrible cancer. And then we recovered, and now we're doing a Simpsons podcast.
That's right. Flip, flip.
No, the couch gag, it's just they're sitting on the couch and they're transported into a comic pop art using the Benday method, with the word bubble over Homer's head saying annoyed grunt, or, you know, dough. That's it.
Yeah.
They got a lot of cram into this episode, Steve.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Let's make it light intro.
Let's just get to it. Our episode begins, as it always does, with the all-too-relatable problem. Homer's trying to button the top button of his dress shirt. He curses his stupid fat neck, especially after he put all that food down in it, and then he takes a deep breath. He gets the button buttoned, but his victory is short-lived, because the button snaps off of his shirt, hits a mirror, and ricochets down his throat. After Homer takes a moment to enjoy the button, he realizes that he's choking.
Well, Steve, Marge, his wife, steps into the dressing room where wearing a fancy form of black dress, asking Homer, what's wrong? So he points to his knee, and it holds up the Days Are Gone LP from the band Haim, and then sticks his tongue out and laps at the air. So Marge puts it together as knee, Haim, lick. Need, Haim, lick. They're really good at charades, aren't they?
Yeah, they are.
I just like how they have a LP of Haim next to... Did you have an LP of Haim in your bedroom?
I bet you I do, but I don't. It's not mine, but I think I do, actually.
Well, Steve, Homer then points to his nose, indicating Marge won. So it's a very funny scene. So she then performs a Heimlich on Homer, causing the button to fly out of his mouth and into the ceiling.
So after Homer compliments her for her well-played moves, Marge asks why he doesn't just buy a shirt with a bigger neck. And Homer claims that he's being neck-shamed, but Marge doesn't really think that that's a thing. Homer asked who made Marge the president of things when Abe walks in, telling them to stop arguing or they'll be late. Homer tells his father that he's wearing the suit that he's supposed to be buried in, and Grandpa is surprised and a little disappointed that they aren't headed to his own funeral. So he walks away, exposing the open back of his suit.
Now, is that true? Like, they have, like the suits when the coroner's... Like, the back is exposed and it just looks like you're wearing a whole suit.
As is my understanding from the show 6 Feet Under and maybe a couple of documentaries or whatever, they do sometimes do that to make it fit better on your body because it doesn't matter what the back looks like.
I just thought, what if it's for, like, ghosts to, like, violate you?
I mean, that's also true. In my personal opinion, I think the whole funeral industrial complex is a deceitful scam looking to... build money out of poor, suffering people. But that's my own opinion.
Which I forgot to ask you. I mean, I was going to ask you off podcast. I just bought a bunch of land that I'm thinking to turn into a funeral cemetery. So if you wanted to work with me, we can have a funeral home.
Oh, sure. Let's milk those mourners out of all the money.
Sounds good. I've been to a couple funeral homes in my day, not to brag or anything.
Oh, la-dee-da.
But I just remember, like, when the guy, like, the suit just looked like he was still from the 70s. Like,
yeah.
I don't know. Like, and the decor just kind of looks sometimes kind of tacky.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember seeing, like, you know, some loved ones and like, the makeup that they put on them. I'm just like, that's not how they looked.
It was right.
Very awkward.
It is, yeah.
Our funeral home, Steve, nothing but nudity.
That's right.
Everyone's naked. And so, you know, we're either crying about our loved one or we're crying because we're naked in front of all these other people.
Exactly. But then, you know, when you have to give up your big speech about Aunt Mary... you won't be embarrassed because you don't need to picture everybody naked because they already are.
Yeah. All right. Write this down. Nudist funeral. Oh. All right. Hey, so they're at this premiere event and Patty and Selma pose for photos in front of Duff Beer sponsored backdrop as a Kimiko and comic book guy wearing a cape arrive at the red carpet in a limo. And then there's like this 360-degree shot of comic book guy in his all caped glory. But it almost looks heroic, too, right?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of, like, the E red carpet coverage that they do.
I wouldn't know. Okay. So Gabbo and Arthur Crandall show up, and then Maggie poses for the paparazzi wearing a black dress, blue bow tie, tiara, and high heels that are far too big for the little baby there, causing her to fall down. Ah, we haven't seen a classic Maggie, like, tripping scenes in a long time. That was, like, her character trait for the first couple seasons.
Yeah,
nice to bring it back. Maybe it's because Al Jean is the writer of this. He's like, I'm bringing back some of the old gags.
I want babies falling down.
So why all this hoopla, Steve? Let's check in here with a clip with Channel 6 on Ken Brockman.
It's the 35th annual Springy Awards, honoring our town's finest. And here's Miss Hoover. Who are you wearing?
Same thing I always wear. I can only afford one dress.
Ah, teachers, we can never repay you for all you do, so we won't. Rainier Wolfcastle, what are you up for? I'm a presenter. I'll be back. stage in the green room gobbling up the caprese panini.
And now, please welcome your host for this evening. He's charming, he's svelte, he's got beer on his belt, Duffman!
Oh yeah! This shamelessly self-indulgent award show is brought to you by Duff Light! Some right-wing groups have accused our beer of being too woke. Let me say, the only thing our beer stands for is getting drunk, getting fat, and buying more till you pass out. God bless America! Can I still say that? Oh, yeah!
So a couple things in that clip. You know, we've talked about how Miss Hoover and Gil, was it last season or the season before, got married. And then sometimes we see her single, we see Gil, no mention. But here, they're together again. But then again, are they really? You know, I'm not jumping ahead of the reveal, but it's very interesting.
You do make a good point, because it is possible that Miss Hoover might have been nominated for an award. You know, you can't go to these things stag, and she doesn't have probably a lot of other people in her life. So she probably called up Gil and like, hey, I know we're not really like together, but do you want to go to the thing with me? So yeah, that would make sense.
Have we had a Springy Award before? Because this seems familiar. I know there was like an episode where there was like an awards event.
Yeah.
And like everyone got an award except for Homer.
Right. So there's the one with Britney Spears. And I'm pretty sure we reviewed that episode where it's the Springfield Achievement Awards or something like that. No, I think it was more like, it looked more like a, I think more like an Emmy. But also there was, when the Olympics were considering going to Springfield, Homer made the Springy mascot.
I remember that, yeah.
And so I kind of feel like it's a conflation of those two things, but I could be wrong. There might be like a more of a Springy award, but it does feel very much familiar.
They could do a whole, like how FXX does the marathon on the weekend, where they're, all the shows have like a similar theme.
Mm-hmm.
I think award show is definitely up there that they can throw this episode in.
Definitely.
Award show. Yeah, other things, there's Duff Light, you know, bringing up the controversy with Bud Light,
mm-hmm.
With a trans person sponsoring it. And then, let's just face it, it was right-wing media making this whole thing an issue, which, you know, really no one cares about.
The ad wasn't, I don't even think, like, on TV. I think it was like an...
No.
I really think it was like an internet ad that probably would have only been shown to, like, people who would be interested in that demographic.
Yes. That's the point of advertising.
Exactly. And I just think that we as consumers need to remember that Bud Light is neither liberal nor conservative. They're only in it for money. And
like all corporations.
Exactly. So. That's capitalism, baby. I'm not saying they're good or bad, because they're not. They're probably more bad than good. But they're in the business of making money. Probably was great for them to have a trans person sponsoring them. Good. To have people mad at a trans person sponsoring them, for them, also good. So when Kid Rock takes his AR-15 or whatever, if you're a gun person and he wasn't an AR-15, I'm sorry. But he shoots up a bunch of beer cans poorly, and then like Bud Light gets news. And so, yeah, it's just a click.
You mean future Vice President Kid Rock?
Yes, yes.
Kid Rock is still like a rich kid from Detroit. Like,
yeah,
Grew up really wealthy. Yeah, let's not forget that, folks. He found a niche in the market of music, like a Larry the Cable Guy, or...
He is like a Larry the Cable Guy. That's a good comparison.
Anyways, another thing. It might be joke gel for me, and it is when Wolf Castle says, I'll be back. Like, the whole, like, saying I'll be back, I don't know.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. That is very tired and well-trod territory, especially for Rainier Wolfcastle, who's just a proxy for Arnold Schwarzenegger, which is, you know, kind of a thing that doesn't exist anymore, that kind of action movie star.
Yeah, I guess the biggest action movie star is Dwayne the Rock Johnson, but now we're all turning on him, so
yeah.
Who's the action star now?
Is it John Cena?
John Cena, yeah. You know, it is... WWE guys, right? Dave Bautista.
Yeah, and I think of all the wrestlers turned actors in recent days, I feel like he is the most compelling, and I would really like to see him, like, compelling art house film or something. I think that'd be fun.
Sure. Let's go with that.
Another thing, that clip that I really enjoyed, that is not joke jail for me, is when they're talking to Krusty, Mr. Teeny sticks a banana where his microphone should be, and the Channel 6 producer just replaces it. I don't know why, but like that quick motion, that behind the scenes person just doing their job so well, I really enjoyed that.
Yeah, without him noticing, right?
Mm-hmm. The award show continues with Mayor Quimby inviting residents to visit the fabulous new Springfield Academy Museum, which features displays of Lard Lad, Jebediah Springfield, and concessions such as a hot dog stand which charges $10 a wiener, and French fries for 25 cents each. The museum is closed Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, but admission is free, although parking is extremely expensive.
Yeah, this is a good bit. Like, mm-hmm. Anywhere you go. I mean, we, you know, inflation, yes, we know there's inflation, but $10 for a hot dog, that seems normal in Portland, but...
Yeah.
I was at a Seattle Mariners baseball game recently, and they have like cheap eats type of things, like a $4 hot dog, which is nice. And it's like, you know, you get the flavor, you get what you need. And I think like $5 beers, maybe it was like Miller Lite, but you know, that's not bad
for a professional sports stadium. That's pretty good.
Yeah. But I understand like the whole museum closed on Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays. Like there's so many things that you want to do sometimes, but like, well, they're closed half the week. There's like some events as well. It's like, oh, the admission is like, you know, that's what the joke is, admission's free, but it'll be like, well, come to the, you know, this thing, admission's only $5 a person. Like, wow, that's cheap. The other thing you get there and the parking's $30.
Right, right. And any sort of like memorabilia or food is exorbitantly expensive. Yeah. And like the clothes thing, like in this town in Portland, Oregon, like there are so many people who work in the service industry that weekends are always busy for those who, you know, go out. And so there's like this curse of the service industry worker, because typically, because they have to work on weekends, their days off are often Monday and Tuesday. And I've experienced this myself as somebody who's worked in the service industry. And so you'll find that if you want to go out to a restaurant on your days off, you can't because they're closed on a Monday or Tuesday.
Yeah, you're part of the problem, Steve, not the solution.
I mean, I think I'm a victim of the problem. I don't know if I'm part of it.
I'm just going to say you are.
Okay, that's fine.
All right, well, Duffman returns to stage, apologizing for an earlier In Memoriam tribute, which claimed someone was dead who was actually still alive, which is now actually dead. Is it Larry? No, it's not Steve. Duffman says it's officially our bad as Hans Molman's picture is shown, saying that he lived from 1931 to now. We then hear Mr. Molman from the audience explaining that he's still alive.
Springfield's Nicest Person Award is next, and Duffman says it's a surprise. Not. That one might be joke jail for me. I just don't know why in the year of our Lord 2024 we're doing not. Like, I don't know if it's like rolled around to be ironically funny. It just feels weird.
Yeah.
But anyway.
I have a theory about this episode, but maybe I should wait till my review.
Alrighty. So Duffman announces that Ned Flanders is the winner of Springfield's Nicest Person, and the orchestra plays Everybody Loves Ned Flanders, which I think is a nice touch, as Ned takes the stage, saying that he doesn't deserve the praise. He asks that, does he do what any man wouldn't? He then says that he's not worthy, as he's being played off. So as women escort him off stage, he thanks everyone for giving him just what he deserves.
While the Simpsons sit in the audience empty-handed, surrounded by Springfieldians with spring-shaped springy awards in their laps, Bart is upset to be skunked again, and Lisa can't believe Maggie lost the Best Silent Baby Award to Gerald. And is missing a little handshake fist at each other, but they didn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're going for the award for Best Sailboat Painting, and, you know, we think of sailboat painting, we think of the Simpsons. But no, it's awarded to Sideshow Mel.
What?
And Marge complains that they have the very same painting, but Mel points out that theirs is askew. So where's a good plumb bob when you need it, Marge? That's a reference to last week's episode about a plumb bob. Also, didn't Marge paint all those sailboat paintings?
Yeah, she did.
Maybe she painted so much that she just gave them away.
I'm thinking that when the Simpsons had a yard sale before the Bush family moved in, Mel probably bought one of those paintings and then, you know. I like this.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, we'll see. I don't know. We won't see. I don't know if I said that.
we won't.
Homer looks at the program for the 35th Annual Springy Awards, asking, will this show never end? We then see inside the program, and next to an ad for the controversial Duff Light is a page dedicated to the Simpsons with the caption, we wouldn't be here without you. Love, the Fox Network. Fun little bit of fourth wall breaking. And luckily for Homer, the last award is about to be announced.
And finally, the award for our town's most underappreciated person.
Mm-hmm.
Who is so modest, they have no idea their name is about to be called. The winner is Marge Simpson!
What? Here you go, Mom.
Hey, Mom!
Marge! Marge! Marge!
Just a dream, but I can still enjoy it 1 minute more.
Marge kicking my ribs.
Lisa's ribs are poking my foot.
Dad, Marge, I'm going to sing in the shower and I need backup.
Mom, all right, I'm getting up.
All a dream.
Yeah, let's discuss this. So the way this episode started seemed normal enough for Springfield and The Simpsons.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't seem wacky enough to be a dream in Simpsons universe. I know we all have dreams in real life and they're all usually pretty damn wacky.
Right.
Is this like a cop-out or... I don't know.
See, I'm thinking back, and I know I shouldn't use like episodes that we just reviewed to compare. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, we talked about that episode where Homer was telling the story of Moe's about how Bart was digging a hole for some reason, and then we had the Morlocks and like the Chinese satellite and all of that. And that was a wacky thing that he was telling a story about because it was something that he was thinking about. And this is kind of similar in a way that Marge had this dream, but it's interesting if you think about it, Marge's dream starts with Homer trying to button a shirt.
Yes.
And then them playing the game of charades. So maybe they're not good at charades, but maybe Marge just wishes they are.
I was going to correct myself when I said that, but I'm like, no, let's just play this out like it's a real episode, you know, a real adventure before we find out it's a dream.
Yeah.
Well, you bring up the episode that we talked about with the satellites, and we kind of enjoyed that.
Mm-hmm.
Because it wasn't a dream. It was just Homer trying to retell the story. He did an okay job.
Right.
You can have a dream like this, but, you know, make it wackier.
Also, the problem is the fact that we've had award shows in Springfield. Like, if we were in a world where it wasn't normal for, like, every member of Springfield to go to a gathering. Like, if you told me about a dream that you had last night where it was the Portlandies and you won an award for biggest Savannah Banana fan, like, that would be weird. If, like, you thought it was, if I thought it was reality and then I learned it was a dream, it's like, oh, that's a weird dream. But here in the reality of The Simpsons, it's interesting to think about what Marge dreamt was pretty commonplace.
You know, they also tell you, like, when you're writing, like, creative writing, that it was all just a dream. It's so hackney.
Mm-hmm.
Never go to that. Now, they can do it, and here I am explaining writing to Algie, and I'm not saying that whatsoever, but I'm saying that, like, you could use the idea of the dream sequence, but not for, like, the first act of this episode. Like, if she's dreaming, make it 20 seconds long, a 20 second long bit.
Mm-hmm.
Not, you know, what were we at, almost 4 minutes or almost 5 minutes into the episode, and this has all been kind of a dream. And even, like, some of the jokes were good, but it wasn't, like, so LOL that you got to keep this material in for this joke, for this dream joke.
Yeah.
So it's like, can we start this in a different way? Because, you know, maybe let's try to make it make sense in the real world. Like, you know how you have a dream about someone, like a friend, loved one, and they wrong you in that dream and you wake up and you're pissed at them,
mm-hmm.
even though they did nothing to you, but you could go like a day or two being mad at that person because of something they did in your dream.
Right.
So if that's what they're kind of doing, this, you know, Marge is kind of like pissed off in this dream when she wakes up. She's like, oh, man. And Homer was kind of a doofus and annoying in the beginning. I don't, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't know what my punch up would be, but that's how I feel about the
It's a little dream, weird.
The
yeah.
dream sequence. Yeah. Well, can we just go to, I guess, real world Springfield now? Marge is all stressed out, and she drives to pay a visit to her mother, who tells her that even when Marge visits, it's worse than when she doesn't visit.
God, I mean,
it's fun seeing Marge's mom every once in a while, too.
Yeah.
And even funnier, the last week episode that we reviewed, Marge pretty much got her mom sent to jail, so it's nice to see her mom out of jail. So next is the vet's office, who tells Marge that Santa's little helper is getting along in the years and has developed Dogheimer's. Marge is confused, but Abe has heard of it. It's not as bad as Kalheimer's. And then he loses his train of thought And Santa's little helper barks, talks to Grandpa. And while a senile man and a canine share a conversation, the vet offers to put either of them down.
A fun little addition there. In the corner, you can see a diploma, but it's not for that guy. It's for Lionel Budgie, played by Michael York, who we've talked about a lot recently, I feel like. But it's so either this vet is his like co-worker assistant, or this guy's an imposter.
Ooh, maybe he murdered him. Maybe. I do like the bit with Santa's Little Helper and Grandpa talking.
Yeah, I think that the dog acting from Santa's Little Helper, very good, even if Matt might not like it. Graining, I mean, not Damon, just because, you know, dog being human, bad. But I think it's a lot of fun. So Marge then goes to with Lisa and Maggie to pick up Bart from Little League, where she finds that Bart has broken both of his middle fingers. Lisa's so grossed out by the broken digits that she can't even enjoy the fact that it was Bart who was injured. So at the emergency room, next to Cletus, who has a fish around his arm from doing some, what is that term for when you fish with your arms? There's a weird hillbilly term for that.
Noodling?
Yes, that's what it is. Thank you. Noodling. And then we have Snake Jailbird, who has a knife in his neck. Marge is texting Homer to asking for help, but she sends text after text asking where he is to no reply.
Well, Homer's at most, Steve. Where else would he be?
Of course.
Right. So he's checking his phone and finds no unread messages. So he sips his Duff and joins Lenny and Carlin spinning in their bar seats. Then Mo looks at his router, which has the Wi-Fi, cell service, and landlines all off. So he laughs to himself, saying that nothing gets through, and the only thing that he wants going through his customers' brains is booze.
Yeah.
That's not how you drink. Does your router say cell service on it?
It just says landline.
Okay. Don't you hate that when you go into like a, I know like we're so addicted to our devices these days, but you would go into like a bar, restaurant, and some reasons like the service doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Not the Wi-Fi, but even like your cell phone service. Like you're almost like in a Faraday cage.
Of course, yeah.
But, you know, maybe we should. We pick out a day of the week, Steve, where we don't use our devices.
I know one guy who does that on Sundays, and it seems to do him well, but he's a weirdo. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're weirdos. We should try it.
That's true. I mean, that's probably healthy for everybody to do, so actually, I might actually try that.
Yeah. Like, do you have, like, a caveat? Like, maybe wake up, just check if anything is, you know, emergencies or whatever that, but then, like, okay, I'll do my daily business in there, set the phone down. You know, maybe turn on your phone so just in case someone tries to call you,
yeah,
for an emergency. But just like keep it away. Go outside for a walk without your device.
That is like probably like even more than social media. That would be hard for me because I'm so addicted to having headphones in my head that if I'm like walking around the house, just doing dishes or doing laundry or doing like household chores, I need a podcast or music at all times. And sometimes I'll go for a walk. And even then, I'll have things in my ears. Like, I always have something playing in my head. So that would be a good exercise for me to, like, go outside and just listen to sounds of nature, such as it is in my neighborhood. And yeah, just experience, like, random sounds that aren't employed by a device.
Yeah, as a former runner / jogger, you know, I used to run with podcasts or music. But then I found, like, if I didn't have any music, nothing in my ears, and I went running, I had a better workout.
Oh.
So, you know, there's something to say for that.
Yeah, I think that's a good point and a good observation. So, yeah, maybe I'll give that a try.
Unless, you know, don't put this podcast down. Just listen to us first, then you put your cell phone down.
Of course, yeah. Us first, right. And then, yeah.
Okay.
So, dizzy from the beer and the spinning, Lenny and Carl fall off their bar seats. Homer, meanwhile, crashes through the window, and the falling shards of glass rip his pants, exposing his butt. Lenny asks who won, and Mo states that he won because he wasn't actually playing. And then on the bar, we see the urn of the recently departed barfly Larry, which I thought was a nice touch. And then we see that a rat begins to chew on the router cord, but Mo tries to shoot it with a shotgun and hits the router, causing it to burst into flames.
Poor rat. I mean, I guess not. He's fine now. So then everyone's phone goes off, and Homer sees that Marge has been trying to reach him all day, and Lenny learns that his father's in the hospital as a patient. Have we ever met Lenny's dad? I want to meet his dad.
Yeah, I don't think we have, so, yeah.
All right, well, maybe we'll cast him. Let's see here. Let's cast Tom Selleck. How about that?
Oh, I like that.
Okay. Well, Homer directly stumbles home and opens the door to find Marge on the couch, arm crossed and angry. He begins to speak, but Marge tells him not a word. So Homer sadly walks up the stairs and asks Marge if she can fix his pants, since his ass is hanging out. Marge tells him to give the pants to her, since that's where all the problems end up. So he throws the pants, and they land on her hair. So as Marge sits on the couch, sewing up the pants, she watches some public broadcasting.
We now return to Trash for Cash.
This seemingly average weather vane was originally made in France.
Makes sense. I bought it in Giverny.
Yes, I'd say the value is, at the very least, $5,000.
We'd be able to cover the whole back 40 in insecticide.
When will I get my insecticide?
My late husband owned these pants. He was a rather large man. Don't much miss him.
The key to the value of these jeans is that both the E's in Levi's are capitalized.
Ooh.
Also, very good for you, these pants have hidden rivets. Which were used before 1967 when open rivets were considered vulgar.
Does it matter that these were frequently worn, including sometimes in bed? Ugh, I'd never visit his grave.
Triss McNeil.
Of course.
The lady, it's so good. I never visit his grave. We're just seeing if, like, Marge is fed up with Homer. This is who she will become.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you ever watch, like, the Antiques Roadshow or...
Well, you know me, like, most TV shows, I got to start from the beginning. So, you know, when I see there's been 4,000 seasons of that show, I just can't.
Yeah, because you'd lose the plot if you dipped in from an episode from, like, 2007. Like, what's going on?
Well, yeah, I just can't follow the narrative. No, I've seen a couple here and there. Not, like, sat down and watched it, but, you know, it'll be on. And I was like, oh, okay, cool.
It's a perfect show for when you're not watching TV, but you just need noise or, like, if you need to, like, kill 15 minutes. Speaking of the background, in the background of that clip, there is a framed Cleveland Spiders baseball jersey that is sold for a fortune. And for those of you who are unaware, the Spiders were a baseball team that played in the majors from 1887 to 1899. They were originally called the Forest Cities and then the Blues, which is funny because that's probably before the music genre, the blues, was even really a thing. But after the first season, it was noticed that the skinny, long-legged players in their black and gray uniforms kind of looked like arachnids. Also, they sucked. No big league team has suffered more losses in one season than the 1899 Cleveland Spiders, who went 20 wins to 134 losses. And they're the only team that has reached the 130-loss mark.
It's surprising that Cleveland, you know, after they had to change their name, or they opted to change their name from the Indians to the Guardians,
mm-hmm.
you know, didn't look back in the past like, man, maybe it could be the Spiders. I'm like, ah, but they kind of sucked.
Yeah. I think Spiders is a fun name, though.
Yeah, but when you think of Spiders, you think of Spider-Man, and then Spider-Man's in New York, so you'd really want, you know, the New York Mets to change their name to the New York Spiders.
Yeah, but... you know that if it was ever cloudy, they would not delay the game because they would just go right up that water spout.
As I say, like, they could have, like, a really cool stadium that the roof, when it closes, it looks like a web or something.
That'd be cool, yeah.
Okay. Well, the appraiser goes on to say that the world of jeans, a highly distressed seed, can increase the value. And he states that the minimum possible value of the pants is $2,600. The owner of the pants remarks that having a husband finally paid off, and Marge, holding the very same jeans in her lap, thinks about her recent stressful times, and then she looks at the pants, and a sly smile grows on her face as she stuffs the blue jeans in her beehive.
So I want to take a moment here, because I think that this episode is offering a point of clarity that we may have discussed, but also has always been a point of confusion. Because it's an animated show, we don't always see the details. But Homer wearing blue pants, I've always wondered whether or not they're denim-like jeans or if they're slacks that happen to be blue.
Hmm.
And I think the fact that these are Levi's, I think it implies that they are, in fact, denim. I know that in the 70s, Levi's did make polyester pants, which are great pants. And if you find them at a thrift store, buy them and send them to me because I love them. But I think that this proves the point that Homer does wear jeans.
But then again, he goes to the power plant in old episodes wearing a tie and a white shirt. Is he like 80s comedian wearing denim jeans and a white shirt with a tie.
What's the deal with nuclear power?
Because then he also wears, like, his Sunday best is, like, the same... Is it the same color blue, or is it a little darker for his, like, suit?
I think it's probably the same. So, yeah, that's a good question.
Unless he, like, wears, like, blue slacks to work and then changes them to jeans when he leaves.
That's possible, like, casual, off
work. Because, you know, like, a lot of people, yeah, will you wear their work clothes at work.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't matter if it's, like, a uniform or a suit or, you know, dress, whatever it is. That you'll wear that to work, and then as soon as you get off, you're like, well, I'm going to meet up some friends. You might put some jeans on or something.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Probably doesn't want to stink up his work outfit at Moe's.
Yeah, and he probably doesn't want to get all the molecules from the nuclear plant on his bar clothes.
Right. Well, I guess we just have to agree to disagree.
I mean, I don't know that we're disagreeing, but I agree that we don't disagree.
That's just how you end a conversation, Steve.
Okay. Well, Marge tells Homer that she was unable to repair his pants and that he'll have to wear something else. Homer asks if he can wear his Speedo to work, but Marge says no. But she does add that they'll be fine, and she gives him a little kiss. And Homer thinks to himself, wow, he makes Marge happy. He then sees the jeans sticking out of Marge's coif and assumes it's a loose hair and pats it down, fixing it.
What an idiot. Can't tell hair from jeans.
Dumbass.
Yeah. So as Marge drives down the road, a parody of Elton John's Leave On plays entitled Levi's, and the singer talks about how valuable the pants are. Meanwhile, Homer arrives at work wearing sweatpants. And he sings over the song talking about those sweatpants and how he'll stretch the waistband as he talks about how the pants cover his gorgeous can. He then pulls out the tag to reveal that they are 8XL, and Homer walks into work, greets the guard, and pays no mind to the sign asking for patience with new security measures, which features Mr. Burns staring into the butthole of an employee. The song goes on as Marge and Homer continue with their day. So it's hard to believe that Homer's pants are 8XL when, like, he walks to the security guard who's clearly bigger than him, like,
yeah,
physically. Anyway, so Marge dons some sparkly pink sunglasses a la Elton John,
mm-hmm,
while Homer sports two donuts as eyewear. So singing as he has sweatpants for the husky man, he falls asleep at his workstation.
So, Craig, the Elton John impersonator is American singer and musician Kip Lennon. And that's probably not a household name, but Lennon has appeared in several episodes of The Simpsons and on the soundtracks and various other media of The Simpsons, but most notably in the now controversial season 3 premiere, Stark Raving Dad, where he provided the singing voice for Leon Kompowski, who believed himself to be the gloved one himself, Michael Jackson. So, in the Michael Jackson episode, it was contracted that Michael Jackson was not allowed, was legally not allowed to sing per his record company, but he was allowed to speak. So in the speaking roles, it was Michael Jackson, but when he sang, it was actually Kip Lennon, who also does a very good Elton John impression. So what a talented guy. Marge nervously steps into the haberdashery, a vintage clothing shop that buys and sells old clothes. Inside, Marge sees Nehru jackets for sale, some 80s neon, and Amazing Spider Pants number 300. Which is the introduction of Venom, and also thinks she sees someone that she recognizes.
Yes, may I help you?
Comic book guy?
No, I am his cousin, Collectible Pants Dude, or CPD, whatever.
I see. Well, I might be interested in selling this vintage item.
Huh, I say. I will give you $20.
Not so fast, Bob. I happen to know these are 501XX Big Double E jeans with hidden rivets.
Zoinks! I see you know pants. In that case, my offer is $22.
I saw a pair on eBay for $3,000.
Fine. Have me, madam, because I must have them. We've never seen such a perfectly distressed rear. I mean, these pants have experienced thousands, I say thousands of pounds of butt pressure.
Yes, he's got a big keister. Are we gonna deal or what?
Sorry, collectible clothes are my one addiction. Also cannabis gummies and the films of Kenneth Anger, but I digress.
So like Marge is like, well, I've seen these pants sell for $3,000, or like on eBay for $3,000. Probably annoys collector stores or, you know, people are trying to sell like a comic book store or anything like that where they're trying to sell collectibles. And when the customer says, well, I've seen this on eBay for this amount of price,
mm-hmm,
it's probably the most annoying thing to the buyer.
Oh, yeah. I can only imagine.
It's like, yeah, I'm sure someone has posted this for $5,000, but is it sold? No.
Right.
Like, I've been to my local comic book store before and just, like, overheard those kind of conversations where, like, someone comes in with their comic books from the 90s. You know, they're like, look, I got Spawn number one in The Death of Superman. And it's like, cool, so does everyone in this country.
Yeah.
They mass produce those for a reason. It's not a collector. You know, 90s comics are worth, like, literally $0, so.
But what if they throw in a Funko Pop?
Funko Pops are the Beanie Babies of the 2020s, aren't they?
Absolutely, yeah.
Tens, yeah. Steve, how many Funko Pops do you have?
Oh.
Be honest.
No, actually, I think I have...
You personally, not people that in the house.
Okay.
You personally.
I have one, honestly. It's a Mr. Burns glow-in-the-dark one, which I bought for a roommate who also bought one for himself, so he gifted it to me.
That's nice.
Yeah.
I have 7.
That's a fair amount. Or are you saying that you have Funko Pops from the film 7?
I just have the head of Gwyneth Paltrow.
Mm-hmm.
Which you can't tell it's Gwyneth Paltrow because all the heads look the same.
Right. And it's in a box.
Like 3, I think, were from like a Think Geek. Not Think Geek. What were those boxes?
Oh, right,
So many more. Loot Crate. 3 of them are from like a Loot Crate. 2 I needed when they came out. And then I have 2. So 4 of them are the only ones that I really care about. I'll just explain those ones. 1 is a Roger Moore James Bond.
Of course.
1 is Conan O'Brien in Lederhosen.
Very nice.
And then I have Tom Servo and Crow from MST3K. And those are the ones that I'm good with.
I like those. None of them are like overly like common. And I think that they're all unique. And so, yeah, I think that's a good collection.
All right. I don't know if I need any more, though. So I quit sending them in, guys.
So Collectible Pants Dude, a cousin of Comic Book Guy, furthers the family, the Albertson family, because you also know Comic Book Gay and Graphic Novel Kid, who also appeared in the show. But he says that his other obsessions, aside from pants, are marijuana gummies and Kenneth Anger films. Now, I agree with him on the edibles. They're great. But Kenneth Anger is an underground experimental filmmaker from the 30s and 40s, and he made a lot of weird, kind of surrealistic films with kind of homoerotic overtones that kind of reference the occult. He's been called one of America's first openly gay filmmakers. He worked with Aleister Crowley. It's a very obscure pull, but I think it's kind of cool to reference something so niche and so weird. So good on you, Collectible Pants Dude.
Yeah, and he only died like a year ago.
Yeah, which is weird.
Yeah.
Born in 1927, and yeah, just passed away almost a year ago.
Wow. As of this record, May 11th, 2023, that's when the man decided to take his life.
Wow.
And die naturally, I'm assuming.
Probably, yeah.
Okay.
So, Collectible Pants Dude offers Marge $2,595 for the pants. He sees that Marge is hesitant, so he looks to zip up the deal and button its fly by waving the cash in front of Marge's face. So Marge watches as Ben Franklin's head is transformed into a pair of golden Levi's, dancing around, shaking its ass. Marge asks to think just a little bit more, but as the owner of the haberdashery points out, she's already put the money in her bag, so she agrees to the deal.
Well, Marge walks out of the store, she looks at the sack of money, and thinks that there are so many things that she can do for her family's future with this cash. She then imagines a college-age Lisa wearing a Yale sweatshirt, complaining that the money Marge gave her only paid for a week of college, and she is then flipping burgers at her hourly job.
So Marge then says to herself, next, and then sees an adult Bart with a neck tattoo of a devil poking out of its leather jacket. Marge is worried that her pants money paid for the neck tattoo and is distraught to learn that it paid for a full chest ink as well as a snake on Bart's face. Marge says to herself, next, and imagines a grown-up Maggie at a pacifier addiction rehab center. So as Marge grumbles at her vision, Mr. Burns and Smithers have their own viewing entertainment, a hit film from the previous summer.
Oppenheimer, I am so sick of hearing about that jerk. Well, I built a bomb, then I was sad when they dropped it.
Boo-hoo!
Aren't you sick of Oppenheimer, Smithers?
Actually, sir, I preferred another movie last summer.
Another movie? Besides Oppenheimer?
That's right.
There was a second movie people were seeing?
Yes, there was. A global phenomenon.
Really? Global, you say?
And it finally gave me the courage to do this.
Hmm. You seem to be bleeding from the head.
It's die.
Die in your own time. Now, regarding Oppenheimer, follow me. Have you fellows heard of tickling the dragon's tail?
Sounds like a DreamWorks film.
Well, it's not. We carefully add small amounts of fissionable uranium, stopping just before critical mass. We can create the most profitable atomic pile of all. Oppenheimer tried it at Los Alamos, but he failed. Idiot! That showboat slides his bony self into every picture. Should have called him Photo Oppenheimer.
Now we know we're like in classic Simpsons territories when they're doing a pop culture reference that I think we've all kind of phased out by now.
Yeah, it's perfectly like far enough to be the right Simpsons reference.
I feel like the whole Barbenheimer phenomenon happened 2 years ago, which it didn't, but it felt like that's how long we've been talking about it.
It does feel like so long ago, yeah.
I mean, that movie's not even a year old yet, so, right? Yeah, I don't think we're there. Maybe we are. I don't know when it came out, but yeah.
Well, Monty Burns brags that his biopic will be longer, clocking in at 7 hours and 23 minutes, or roughly half of Killers of the Flower Moon. Zing. He then goes on to say that he is a skinnier star, and that global annihilation will not be hinted at, but actually a rather heartwarming climax. As Smither reminds Burns that if he exceeds critical mass, it would lead to a nuclear explosion, that very thing is about to happen. So as the Geiger counters go off the scale, Lenny warns that the plant is about to blow. But Carl dismisses Lenny's warning, calling him an alarmist.
Well, the workers try to help, but find that their hazmat suits are too bulky. Luckily, Homer is there, moving with comfort and ease to save the day. Mr. Burns tells Smithers that a sweat-panted Superman rescued them all. Homer modestly says that he puts his sweatpants one leg at a time, like any fat guy. Monty is grateful, so he's giving Homer 2 front row tickets to a baseball game. He adds that his debt is now paid and Homer should never talk to him again. You know, we haven't really talked about like the Homer and the sweatpants.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like the idea of the fat, lazy dude in sweatpants is another old trope.
Mm-hmm.
Because I see a lot of the younger generation of kids like embrace the sweatpant.
From my experience, the idea of a younger, like 20-something, showing up to work in sweatpants, not that rare.
Wow. I remember wearing sweatpants as a kid and being totally like, these are fine. But then as soon as I started going through puberty, I'm like, these are not fine.
Exactly. Yeah. I had a very similar experience.
Like, I have pajama pants, but I don't wear them in public.
Right.
I wear them for pajama time.
Mm-hmm.
But the sweatpants, like, I have a pair and I put them on. I'm like, how are these comfortable? I don't like sweatpants.
No, they're too hot.
Exactly. I get too hot.
Yeah.
I'm fat dude short wear, so even if it's cold, I'm wearing shorts
because
I'm fat dude short wear.
I love shorts.
It's probably an easier way to... No, you don't. I've never seen you wear shorts.
No, but as like a lounge wear, I like a short.
Okay.
But yeah, that's correct. Don't wear shorts in public. No.
Yeah, there's many times I've picked you up in the middle of August and like you're wearing a sweater and jeans and a jacket and I'm wearing short shorts and a tank top because it's fucking 102 degrees outside.
I'll have you know that I've recently gone down to wearing one layer of on top at a time.
Wow.
And sometimes that layer is just a t-shirt. That's very
that
weird.
That says Puppy Guns or maybe a Sousa in the font of Metallica or, I don't know, Welcome to Springfield, 2-drink minimum.
Nuts Can Kill.
Yeah. Something like that on a t-shirt?
Yeah, or maybe when you're a woman and you have a voice, wait, you got a personality. That's my favorite.
You mean this one, Steve?
If you're a woman and you've got a voice, you've got a personality.
Exactly.
And where can you find all of those fun t-shirts?
Why, you can just go to tpublic.com/user/annoyedgruntboys and you can get your very own shirt like that.
And there's probably a sale going on right now.
Yep, there always is. So Marge walks through the ritzy section of Springfield past the Nada store, looking through the window of Abercrombie and Rich. She really thought that she'd enjoy the money, but she's not happy. Barney, lying on the ground, says that she does not envy Marge. He adds that when life gives you lemons, make lemonade. Add vodka and then meet him down on the ground. So Marge walks over Barney and heads for some guidance.
Well, in the office of Reverend Lovejoy, Marge asks, what their faith says about spending money on something just for yourself. Lovejoy, seeing the large sum of money, says that he doesn't know, but, you know, for $20, he'll wipe the communion cup before Marge drinks from it. So Marge stuffs some money in the collection box and then walks away.
So in the background of that scene, Lovejoy has two sermon notes on his whiteboard, and they're showing passages from the Bible. One is 1 Corinthians 6:9-11. Never forget. And it's, I don't know Bible speak, but it seems to be wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not be deceived. And then it talks about sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers. Basically, it's some alleged homophobic shit. But like, honestly, I don't want to get into the Bible because we're not a religious podcast. But that's been like so translated in so many different ways, and it's been so diluted that it's probably not even what they meant. And then the other one is John 1:1-14, never forget, which is talking about a guy named John who believed in God, I guess. I don't know. But
that's fun.
Yeah, so if you're a religious person, you can like examine that more.
Do you think that those were put on there on purpose, or do you just think that whoever put them on in the animation was like, make something up?
What I think it is, and I could be wrong, I think it's to point out that Lovejoy is looking for things to point out wrong about people, when in reality, his indifference towards Marge and just like looking to get some greedy money, much like the church system in general, is kind of showing the hypocrisy of the church in general, like judging people when really all they're doing is asking for money and to be tax-free. But that's my own take on it, and I could be wrong.
Yeah, hey, again, not a religious podcast, but tax the churches, guy.
That's right.
Well, in front of Saks, it's just the dollar sign is the S, and then after the K is the S, so Saks. I get it. The Rolex store and Neiman markup. Marge calls Homer. She earnestly says that after a lot of soul searching, there's something that she needs to tell him. And after hearing the background noise, Marge discovers that Homer is attending a baseball game. As Homer describes the fun that he's having, Marge wonders who he's with.
Oh. Are you there alone?
Well, I asked Lenny, but he was busy. Carl was out sick. Smitty was taking or teaching a Pilates class, I forget which. So I finally asked that new guy from Ghana.
I have so many questions about your baseball. First, why?
Homer, how come you didn't ask me?
Well, you don't like baseball.
Maybe, but more importantly, I like being asked.
Oh my god, oh my god. Can I get you a jersey? What's your size again?
Medium. It's always been medium.
It's something I should have known, right?
Buster, you should know whether or not you should have known it. But thanks for clearing things up for me.
You're welcome. Do we get another kiss?
Oh, you'll get a kiss, all right. You're gonna get a big kiss. You just wait for that kiss.
If you come here, we can get it on the kiss cam. Dial tone. Hello? Marge? Marge? Hello? Dial tone.
No, I have to kiss him? Well, if it's all part of baseball.
Very sweet of the guy.
Sounds like an exciting experience at a baseball game. Sorry, Ghanaian co-worker. Baseball's a lot of fun to watch. Because, you know, beer, hot dogs, all that fun stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a baseball fan by any means, but I'll go to a baseball game. It's a fun day at the ballpark.
Any sporting event is more fun live.
It's true. Marge is fed up, so she steps into Spiffany's looking for the biggest ring that she can buy. The yes guy says that it's a coincidence, as he wants her to have the biggest ring that she can sell. Yes. So he states that the rule of thumb is that a meaningful ring should cost 3 months' salary. And folks, if you're out there shopping for a ring, that's bullshit. Don't do that. But Marge asks if she doesn't have a salary, if it's free, and the yes guy firmly says no. So as Marge sports a ring with a large blue diamond on it, she asks about the return policy. The jewelry dealer says that Marge has a full 3 seconds to change her mind. And after those 3 seconds go by, Marge walks out of the store. She assumed that she'd be happy, but the guilt starts to affect both her mind and her body.
Oh my god, I didn't know I'd feel so guilty walking around wearing something so expensive. Calm down, Marge. Calm down. Nobody cares.
Marge, I was a couple of blocks away, and I couldn't help noticing you wearing something your husband couldn't possibly afford.
Tattletale!
A casual Christian.
Remember, sale's final.
Okay, can't return it. Might as well enjoy it. A guilt rash. The last time I got one of these was when I took that bottle of shampoo from the hotel. It wasn't open. They could have reused it.
I still do it as a adult. Like, if I'm at a hotel, I'm like, yeah, I'll take it. Like, at most, too, like, those little, like, the body soaps or whatever, mm-hmm. the shampoos, like, you could get maybe a wash out of it.
Right.
You know, I see when I take those. I'll take some of the cape pods.
Mm-hmm.
I'll take the remote, you know.
Yeah.
To the TV. The table and chair that's in there, I'll take that. The safe, I'll take the safe because it's kind of fun.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'll have to steal the pool.
Yeah, I've taken a few jacuzzis in my day.
Yeah.
Although there's some hotels, I'm like, oh, man, someone already got the carpet and the wallpaper because they're pretty torn up.
Mm-hmm.
You know what most hotels should have is a plunger in each room, but they don't. I'm not saying I need it, but it's a sense of security because I'd rather have there be a plunger in the room rather than me calling to the front desk asking for a plunger.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing worse than like 9:30 at night and you feel the need that you have to call, that you need a plunger.
Yeah.
And it's got to be the most embarrassing thing in the world. So, yeah, I agree.
Is it because you just want to give the your guest, and this is same for you, Steve, when you worked in hospitality,
mm-hmm.
that you just want to give them a look of shame when you hand them the plunger?
Yeah, like you're bad at pooping or you're too good at pooping or your pooping is unusual. So, yeah, shame on you.
We shouldn't be poop shaming on this podcast, Steve. It's not a thing? Okay.
I mean, it probably is a thing.
Well, Marge places the ring in his box and then sticks the box in the kitchen drawer for safekeeping. She then grows concerned that someone will find it, so she attempts to find another spot. So she tries a cabinet, and then a turkey carcass inside of the dishwasher, and then a cabinet again. So she discovers that this is what having a secret feels like. So she finds it to be terrible, and then wonders why everyone does it.
She then goes to hide the ring in an oatmeal carton marked pencils, but finds that it's full of cookies. She wonders how many places around the house Homer hides cookies, and then she goes to hide the ring in the fridge's vegetable crisper, and she learns that that is full of cookies as well. And then she opens the freezer, and boom, more cookies.
Are we supposed to believe that Homer stores cookies? I feel like he would just eat them all and not have a special cookie hiding spot.
Right.
I mean, I like this idea of hiding cookies.
I mean, it would be nice if you, like, came home from Moe's a little drunk and you just open up a thing like, oh, cookies. That would be nice.
What would you like to hide? I like a cookie. You know, I like a cookie. I'm just trying to think if there's any other, like, non-perishable items. I mean, all cookies are, but, like, you can't put, like, a Taco Bell taco, hide those, and then it'll be perfectly fine months from now, although it probably would be, but...
Sadly, yes.
Yeah. I guess, cookie... Like, you could have, like Reese's peanut butter cups just like hiding all over the house and we find one that's a treat.
That's a good one. I've done that before where like I'll get like the mini peanut butter cups and I will kind of stick them in a spot that I don't readily go to. And so then I find them like, oh, cool.
Marge then heads to the attic to hide the ring behind a box marked things were too embarrassed to return to Flanders. What is it? Like Maud's marital aids?
Marital aids.
I don't want to say vibrator, Steve.
That's a quaint thing.
Well, I'm trying to, like, say it appropriate the way Flanders would.
Yeah. Do you think it's like a big old dildo shaped like Jesus?
There's not a dildo big enough to match Flanders' hog. She probably has, like, average size, you know, just to, like, be normal.
Right? Yeah.
Anyway, she tells herself that no one can find the ring, but now she learns she's not alone.
Who are you talking to, Mom?
Dad! What are you doing here?
Oh, I like to look at my old report cards. One teacher, if you could believe it, gave me an A++. They're not allowed to do that anymore. It makes the other kids feel bad. And that's why we're losing to China.
Yo.
Yeah! What are you doing in the attic?
Well, one thing I'm definitely not doing is hiding from the cops.
We'll never find them. Let's go, boys.
Was it like when you were in elementary school, you got the report card... And then, like, you get to look at, oh, man, those were, like, so stressful days.
Yeah, they were.
Like, you get the report card, you look at it, and it was like on the, what are they called, pink and yellow paper.
Yeah, like, almost like a dot matrix printer or, not even that.
But, no, it's like, because you had to have it signed and then bring back the pink.
Oh, yeah, like a carbon paper, yeah.
Carbon paper, yeah. It was like carbon paper because you saw it, and then you had to have your parents' signature on it and bring it back the next day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, knowing that your parents saw it. So there'd be times where, like, you didn't want to... Sure. Well, my mom was always on top of, like, when report card day was.
Yeah.
So... And I never did the... I mean, I got decent grades. You know, I never had to turn a an F into an A like Bart did or something like that. But yeah, those were like stressful days as a kid.
Yeah.
Thank God there's not podcast report cards, Steve.
Oh, man. Yeah. It doesn't work well with listeners.
Oh, it's true.
All right. So it seems that Bart is hiding from the police because he spray painted Chief Wiggum's visage on the trunk of the squad car with the words donut box and an arrow pointing to Wiggum. Clancy remarks that there's no respect for the law before suggesting that they get some donuts. Conveniently, the trunk is full of donuts. So they just have a trunk full of donuts, as cops are wont to do, I assume.
Mm. Well, Marge tells Bart to get to bed. And then here's another sound. And it's Maggie sucking. But it's not her usual pacifier in her mouth. It's the blue diamond ring. And Marge sees that her youngest child isn't judging her. And then she can enjoy the ring with Maggie.
Aw, very nice. So meanwhile, at Moe's, Homer's beginning to realize that he doesn't appreciate Marge enough. Finally. She does everything for him, and he just takes her for granted. Moe agrees, saying that Homer is lucky that Marge doesn't leave him for the next tall, dark, and handsome guy that comes along. Moe then imagines Marge looking into his eyes, saying, "Oh, Moe, I love the way you introduced me to this guy." We then see a guy who looks an awfully lot like Homer, but with a full head of hair and a mustache, saying, "Woohoo!" Moe, flipping a coin across his knuckles, informs Homer of the issues in song.
Do you want me to sing it or play the clip?
Yes. Why can't we do both?
She's a mad wife, Homer J, with tears behind her smile.
Happy tears?
You treat her like she's nothing, unless your gut needs stuffing.
What the?
As a husband, I would rate you beneath Henry VIII. You really are a selfish guy. You really are, all things considered, a nearly spherical, full of miracle, incredibly selfish guy.
Before you, I rode through dog poop.
He's got dog duty all over his clothes.
Ew.
A Grinch parody, Steve.
Yeah, that seems relevant to the episode and the time in which we're watching this.
That's fine, Steve. It's fine. Don't be an annoyed grunt boy.
I'm sorry.
Wait a minute. That's what we are. Yeah, I forgot. Be as annoyed as you want, Steve. Well, hey, Marge sits at home alone, learning that she'll just have to live with her selfishness. So she walks upstairs, leaving the ring in plain sight. So Homer returns and finds the fancy ring and the receipt, showing that she bought it for herself. At first, he feels that she's been holding back on the rest of the family. He says, oh my God, the things she does. He then walks into the kitchen to find a tray of freshly baked cookies for Bart and Lisa and Maggie, followed by a second tray just for him that he'll end up probably just hiding somewhere, right? And he says again, the things she does, and Homer walks up the stairs and sees a photo of a party she threw with all of his friends, and the banner explains it was just because she loves him. The thing she does, he repeats. He then finds a pair of tickets to a baseball game for the two of them. The things she does, all the wonderful things she does. Homer thinks about the sweet notes Marge adds to his lunch every day, getting everyone a birthday present and saying it's from the both of them. And even in her sleep, Marge is perfect, sticking a coaster under Homer's bottle of beer as he tries to set it down. So Homer knows that with all the wonderful things that Marge does, he can only do one thing with that ring. So he pulls his pants down and he shoves it on his little wiener. And now it's a cock ring.
Anything can.
No, that's not what happens, Steve. He just puts the ring back on her finger.
Aw. So Marge wakes up to find that Homer put the ring on her. And he tells her that he wishes he bought it for her. And they look lovingly at each other. And as the credits begin to roll, Marge takes a moment to enjoy her ring, guilt-free.
Finally, no guilt.
Breaking news! Amnesty International has identified the Spiffany Blue Diamond as the most unethically mined gem in human history. It takes 6 blue whales to color each carat. Wearing this is a sparkly expression that you love misery.
I'll just wear the ring inside for a little.
That's a great stinger to the episode, Steve. It also, like, is great for us nerds being like, but where's the new dog? We never see the new dog. Or where's Marge's new ring? Well, now let's explain, because it'll be horrible for her to wear it.
Exactly. And with those loose ends all tied up, that's our episode. Let's take a break. Think about what we just saw. and we'll come back and talk about it.
Yeah, we will.
We'll be right back.
Homer's Levi's sizes huskier, but he's still too fat, they say.
Hey!
That's because he's a fat man.
They're making pants too small these days.
You pants are fat too man. Small. Woo!
Okay, Craig, we're back. Let's finish up our discussion of the Telltale Pants. We'll talk about what we liked, what we didn't like, what made us laugh, and a most valuable jokester. And we will find out what we're watching next week. But before we do all of that, let's get in the spirit of gift giving, as is always a good thing to do. And so for you, Craig, I know you're a bit of a sports fan, so I got you tickets for you and I to go to a baseball game.
I mean, I wish that was real.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be fun. And, like, also, before, like, we go to the game, we can stop by the museum. And we don't have to go see the Springfield sights, but I will buy you a $10 hot dog and, like, $2 worth of fries. So that's, like, 8 fries. So, yeah.
Are we going to a Portland Pickles game or a Hillsboro Hops? Are we driving down to Eugene to see the Eugene Emeralds or Major League and driving to Seattle for a Mariners game, Steve?
I want to say dealer's choice, but I mean, let's just say for the sake of economics, let's keep it in Oregon.
All right. We'll stick with the Pickles. I don't really like that neighborhood, but I guess we'll go. Let's go to Hillsboro Hops, all right?
Okay, that's the Hillsboro Hops. Yeah.
Okay. They're the single A, high single A for the Arizona Diamondbacks, so get out your Diamondbacks hat, Steve.
Oh, yes.
World Series players of last year.
Of course.
Not champions, Steve, but, you know, they lost in 4 games, I think. Yeah. Okay. Hey, again, not a baseball podcast, but seems like we have been lately. That's my fault. My turn.
Okay.
What do you want? Gift first or?
Yeah.
Is that how we do this? Okay. Not my ranking first?
Not yet.
You know, there's been a lot of talk about, like, the youth culture on this episode, even in the past. And I thought, maybe you need to relate to some of the kids. And that's why I got you some gray sweatpants so you can blend in with the youth of the day, of today, I mean. And, let's throw in a case of Duff Light.
Oh, nice.
Because you're woke, Steve.
So much so that I wouldn't even say that because it feels problematic to say, considering that people have co-opted the term so much. So, yeah, thank you, Craig. I appreciate that.
That's what we're supposed to do. But, if you look at it now, like, youth generation will think you're cool. You got your Duff Light and gray sweatpants. But back in the 80s or 90s, people think you're a loser. But not now, Steve.
It's
not
true.
Now.
Yeah, there's nothing sad about a 42-year-old man hanging out with a bunch of 23-year-olds drinking beer in sweatpants.
And if you look behind you in that old can of instant oatmeal, Steve, you'll notice that there's hidden cookies.
Hey, cookies.
That's all. That's all you get.
Oh, that's very nice, Craig. I appreciate that. But what a real gift from you would be to know what you thought of this episode. What made you laugh?
Oh, yeah. Before I give the full and final review. Look, there's some fun stuff from the Marge's dream sequence in the beginning, even though we, talked a little bit negatively about it. But, some of the, like the charade scene was really well done.
Mm-hmm.
Even liked little Maggie's pose on the red carpet, wearing the heels. Very cute. The commentary about how parking's expensive everywhere and everything just sucks. Do anything. But then we get into the heart of the episode, Steve.
Ah, yes.
And I liked the banter. I liked the banter between Santa's Little Helper and Abe. And I liked Harry Shearer talking to Harry Shearer when Smithers and Burns are talking about Oppenheimer and Barbie. Even though it was like a dated reference, but I liked how it was Burns oblivious to the fact of Barbie. It's kind of a fun little banter scene, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The baseball stuff was good. It's nice to see returning characters. I did like the bit of Marge trying to hide in the attic, and then everyone's going to the attic.
Mm-hmm.
Nice little touch. If I had to give an MVJ, J is the middle initial for Homer and his middle name. But do I give it to Homer? Who was my most valuable jokester? You know what? I'm going to give it to Tress McNeil for the widower of the pants husband on the Antique Roadshow parody.
Nice.
That's my MVJ. Yeah. My favorite scene and just her delivery. So there you go. Tress MacNeille, her character. It's the MVJ, Steve. How about you?
Very nice. Yeah. So I did enjoy the, I thought, like you said, the Heimlich maneuver charades was very witty. I really like that the silent movement of the producer replacing Mr. Teeny's banana with the microphone. Thought that was really well done. I enjoyed the yes guy and his banter with Marge. The idea of Marge just going to all these different tasks, like going to her mother and being like, oh, you're worse because you visited, going to the vet and be like, oh, your dog has a mental deficiency, and then having him to talk. Just that, like, kind of like the downtrodden thing that Marge is experiencing. It's sad, but it's well done. Also, I figure there's kind of, it's not funny, but there's a sweetness to Homer kind of being like, oh, the things that she does. Like, it feels a little, like, writerly, but I enjoyed that, what Al did with that. But for jokes, weirdly, I think Lenny and Carl had some fun banter. I like that Lenny warning about a nuclear explosion and Carl calling him an alarmist is kind of funny to me. I liked Burns and Smithers talking to each other about Barbenheimer. But if I had to give a jokester, which I suppose that I do, what one individual made me laugh the most? Weirdly, I think I'm going to give it to Collectible Pants Dude, just because he's such a weird character who is, you know, I realize just a take on comic book guy, but I like his niche interests. And, you know, I've known denim heads in the past who are not unlike that. So I'm going to give it to him. But there's good performances all around. I think that, like you say, Tress did a great job. I think the yes guy is always fun to see. He's like a classier version of Raphael.
The turtle?
Yes, exactly. He's also cool but rude, but in a different way. Right. Classier way. And, you know, he wears a red flower, which is not unlike a red bandana. He often exhales air or sighs, much like Raphael does.
Dumb.
It is. I am an idiot. But you're not an idiot, Frank. So what did you think of this episode, all in all?
All right. I teased it in the episode.
Yes.
And what I think about this. I think this episode was written in the 90s. I think it's been shelved since then. And then they were looking to get another story break in the writer's room. And Al Jean's like, look, I have this script that I wrote in 97. And, you know, I think it could work now. Just do a little touch-ups here. Put some pop culture references of the day, like Barbenheimer, the state of capitalism. That'll keep this cringe joke in. And, this Terminator, I'll be back reference. It's still timely. I'll keep that in there. And like, oh, it was nice. We're also talking about blood diamonds. You know, this is in the news. I'll keep that in there. I'll call it the blue diamond. Okay, here we go. Kids still fret about report cards. Yeah, they're still in physical card form. Anyways, here we go, guys. I wrote this episode 97. Punch up what you can. I'm still going to credit myself as writing this because I did 30 years ago. So that's how I feel about this episode. That Al Jean wrote this, had it shelved. They needed an episode. And let's do this. Also, maybe at the time, he was just thinking like, man, my wife does so much for me. So I'll write this little love letter at the end of the episode and just tag it on with, that's how we resolve this episode. Homer figuring it out. And, you know, Marge looks kind of happy at the end. And she probably would wake up like totally done, like, you know, not regretting this at all. But yeah, this episode, like I said, there's a high bar with Al Jean's name on it. And you don't want to upset the second in command of the Simpsons.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of critical on the Homer fucks up something for Marge and he's got to correct it somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess people make regrets of purchases. We all have that. And Marge is like, you know, the most selfless character. We get it. And maybe she almost snapped, but she didn't. Yeah, there we go. So, hey, I'll give it a ranking. We learned that Hans Molman's birth date was 1931. And he died now, and so we'll just say the now date will be 2024 when this episode came out. So it's a nice 93 years. So out of 93, I'll give this episode the age I hope to die, 69.
Nice.
How about you, Steve?
Great score. Great position. Al Jean is nothing short of a TV legend. His work on Critic, his work on The Tonight Show. He's done a lot of things, and that should be remembered. This episode just felt like such the, like, cookie cutter. I know there's a lot of cookies in this episode, but just such a cookie cutter episode that is just not that interesting. The economy of the Simpsons family it makes me kind of wonder because, sure, Marge sold the pants that were technically Homer's, but because they're a single income family most of the time with Homer working at the plant, everything kind of comes from his bank account. And because she sews and does so much, I don't know that it's entirely his pants anyway. I'm not trying to poke holes in the logic of the episode, but I just feel like it just feels so, as you said, like sitcom-y, so tropey. And I just feel like we've seen this story done better, even probably written by Al Jean himself. And also the concept of the guilty item, the telltale heart. We saw it in the Telltale Head, which Al Jean wrote. We saw it in the Lisa's Rival episode with the Telltale Heart diorama. So they've done the Telltale concept before. This episode didn't really hit for me, I guess is what I'm saying. There are some fun parts. I thought the opening dream sequence was good, and I was a little disappointed that it became a dream sequence because it was kind of fun. For me, the episode kind of went downhill from there. I just felt like the characters were just kind of going through the motions, and it felt really old-fashioned and really kind of unnecessary. This is kind of a miss for me. I don't know that it's like, it's certainly not like a horrible episode, and I think Al Jean did a fine job. If I were to give it a score, they mentioned the Cleveland Spiders. In their 1899 last season, they allowed 1,252 runs while only scoring 529 themselves. So out of 529 runs, I'm going to give this, we'll say, 375 out of 529.
Yeah, as, you know, you would say, we don't need to agree to disagree. We just agree to agree on this one. And it's fine. It's kind of one of the, I guess, few skip episodes, I feel like. I think it's not necessary. You know, sadly. Sorry, Al. Can't win them all, Steve.
That's right. And maybe this one wasn't quite a winner for us, but maybe next week will be.
Maybe we should call Al Jean Al Cleveland Spiders Jean.
Oh,
I like them all.
Yep. But Craig, maybe, just maybe, next week will be a home run for those spiders. And luckily, we don't need to bust out the Wheel of Random because we have another new episode next week. Craig, what do you think the title of that episode is?
Well, Steve, of course, this is the Telltale Pant based off of the Telltale Heart. They've already done a parody of this title. So, you know, with no reason at all, I'm going to say next week's is going to be another parody of an episode that they've already done. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
They use the Telltale Heart as an episode title. So I'm going to say it's going to be called Marge versus the Monorail versus Camp Krusty versus Colonel Homer versus Some Enchanted Evening.
Wow.
That's it. It's over.
That does sound like a very good and packed episode of The Simpsons, but sadly...
Wait, what was the title again, Steve? What did I say it was?
Marge versus the Monorail versus Camp Krusty.
Okay.
Versus Colonel Homer versus Homer at the Bat. Is that what it was?
No, it was... you and I forget. Was it versus Some Enchanted Evening?
That's how it ended, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so it's not... Okay, what is it actually called, Steve?
So it is called The Tipping Point.
The Tipping Point. Tipping. Tipping is not a city in China, so maybe that point. Point is what you do with your finger, but you're not supposed to do it because it's rude. So I'm going to say that, you know, we try to make jokes on this podcast, but like tipping, the only thing I can think of is, you know, what you do if you stand up in a canoe. So I think Homer and Barney and Lenny and Carl all go on a canoe trip, and they get lost on the river, and Homer decides to stand up, and, well, they don't actually, you know, fall over in that canoe, but they get ashore, they're lost in the woods, and they have to survive by murdering wildlife, and the B-story, Bart, finds out he's not circumcised, so he asks for a circumcision, and Marge says, okay.
Wow. Sounds like a great and controversial episode. However, I don't know that it's exactly right, because the information that I have is the tipping point is about Homer loses his mind over tipping culture run amok.
I'm excited for this episode because I agree. It's gone a little crazy to the fact that you're like, any store you go to, you know, when you tap your card or whatever, And it's like, you know, you're making a purchase for a pair of Levi's jeans or, you know, a t-shirt, and they're asking for a tip. Like, what is this about? Now to sound like a Fox News reporter, but...
Reporter. Reporter in quotes. I feel like this will ignite a lot of good debate about the nature of tipping. Because, yeah, I have some thoughts on it too, both positive and negative.
You've worked in... I've worked, obviously, in cultures where you're tipped.
Right.
But there's sometimes where I'm just like, do I need to tip the kid at the fast food counter? Again, sound like an old person, but do I need a tip for the job they're supposed to be doing?
Right. And this is something we'll certainly get into next week because, I think that it's a complex issue that we can certainly get into. But before we do that, we want to hear from you. So, hey, if you want to reach out to us, you can go to socials like Instagram or Threads at 13Simpsons, or you can always email us at 13Simpsons@gmail.com.
And you can always leave us a voicemail. Just go through the show's notes. There's a little button that says leave a voicemail, and you can do that. We want to hear from you and your voice. Don't forget to leave us a 5-star or the equivalent review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you get your lovely podcasts. But you don't have to write a real review. No. You just write a little blurb or a line. Just tell us, I don't know, what you would buy for $2,600 and be ashamed of it.
If you're so kind and you want to get some cool gear, some annoyed grunt boy gear, we mentioned it earlier, but you can go to tpublic.com/users/annoyedgruntboys and get yourself an awesome t-shirt or maybe a mug or a sticker or a refrigerator magnet so you know where you hid your cookies. That isn't in the cookie jar.
Yum, yum.
Alrighty, for this week, I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve.
And I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig.
And remember, I've never seen such a perfectly distressed rear.
I'm going to sing in the shower and I need backup.
When will I get my insecticide?